So many of you have been asking for this episode. Well, here it comes. Let's configure a firewall with OpenWRT and separate our IoT devices and guest Wi-Fi from the LAN. Actually, I've had so many questions from you guys that we need to split this in two episodes. Here's what we will do. First episode, we will look into a firewall configuration for our internal LAN, a guest network, and a separate network for our IoT devices. In the second episode, we will extend the LAN, guest, and IoT Wi-Fi to a second access point using VLANs. Stay tuned. Let's log into the web interface, which is called Lucy, of our first OpenWRT router. By default, this is the 192.168.1.1 address. Here we go. To network, then firewall. As you can see, there are already two firewall zones predefined, namely LAN, which is our internal network, and WAN, which is basically the internet. Now, let's not bother too much for the time being what the settings here mean. I will explain them later. What we will do as a first step is that we create two more zones by clicking on Add. Let's call the first one Guest Zone and Safe. Same thing for IoT Zone and Safe. Then, important, click on Save and Apply. Let me quickly explain what we want to achieve. Nobody should be able to get into any of our networks from the WAN interface. Our guests should be able to browse the internet, so they need to be able to get to the WAN zone. But they should not get anywhere else. We do not want guests to browse our internal network. My IoT devices, such as my vacuum cleaner, should not be able to get outside in any way. I don't want these devices to phone home to the vendor. So they should be confined within their zone. People in the internal LAN should be able to browse the internet, plus they should be able to browse the IoT zone. For example, web interfaces of cameras which are in the IoT zone, etc. Looking at the config page in Lucy, here we can see that there are mainly three different settings that can be defined. Those are Input, Output, and Forward. The possible settings are Accept, Drop, or Reject. What do they all mean? When a packet of data arrives at one of the router's interfaces, it can either be for the router itself, so it is a packet for the local host, or for a process running on the router. Typical examples would be HTTP, like we just did with the web interface. The process that serves this interface is running on the router. Or, alternatively, the packet could be for a different network. An example would be if we browse the internet. Then the input interface would be the LAN interface, and the output interface would be the WAN interface. So as a first step, we need some magic here to decide where the packet wants to go and whether we accept it or whether we deny or drop it. Under Linux, this is typically done with IP tables. IP tables have so-called chains. The most basic chains are input, output, and forward. If something wants to speak to a process on the router, then it needs to go through the input chain first. If a process on the router wants to speak to the outside world, then the packet needs to go through the output chain. If a packet wants to go from one zone to another, then it will need to go through the forward chain. If I wanted to browse to a page in the internet, for example google.com, then I would first send a packet with a DNS request to the DNS server on the router in order to find Google's IP address. So this needs to go through the input chain. The DNS daemon on the router would then need to ask a DNS server in the internet for Google's IP address. This request would go through the output chain. Once I have Google's IP address, then my browser would try and establish a connection with it in the internet. So this request would go through the forward chain. IP tables has, like the name suggests, also various tables. The most important tables are called raw, mangle, filter, and NAT. Each table can contain rules for various chains. This looks very complex, but don't be afraid. We can simplify this to a large extent. In real life, for 99.9% of the cases, we only need the filter tables. Plus, we might occasionally need pre- and post-routing in order to NAT or rather masquerade addresses. We'll come to that later. For the time being, we will concentrate on input, output, and forward. Back to our Lucy interface. With what we know now, we can much better understand the settings on this page. On the top, we can see that there is a default setting. This accepts input, so things for processes running on the router such as DNS, DHCP, the web interface, or SSH access to the router. It has an accept on the output chain, so all processes running on the router by default may access all other zones. And forward is set to reject, so by default everything is kept in its own zone. Now let's apply the rules for the different zones. First, the WAN zone. Here we don't really need to change anything. We want to reject incoming traffic. Let's move to the LAN zone. The default settings are okay for what we want to do. All three values are set to accept. Now there is just one thing to be aware of with regards to the forward settings. Forwarding from one zone to the other is shown in this left column, and what this forward setting on the right means is forwarding between networks in the same zone. Presumably, by default, you won't have different networks in one zone, so don't bother too much about the setting on the right. The most important one is the one on the left. Let's see how we can modify this. We do this by clicking on Edit. Let's do the first change here. We want our LAN users to be able to browse to the IoT zone. So at the bottom of the zone settings, we open the drop-down box that says Allow forward to destination zones and tick the IoT box. Let's save. The settings for IoT seem to be okay. I do not expect an IoT device to open the browser page on my router, so we can leave input accepted. Now for our guests. We do not want our guests to open the web page of the router configuration or try to SSH into the router. So we set input to reject. We do, however, want them to be able to browse the internet. So we need to edit. Then again, go down to the bottom of the zone settings, then open the drop-down box that says Allow forward to destination zones and tick the WAN box. Let's save. Before we click Save and Apply, let's quickly double check. LAN can go to the WAN and to IoT. It can access the router itself. IoT is blocked from everything except the router itself. Guests can only go to the internet, but not the router itself or any other zone. Looks good so far. Let's save and apply. Before we define the network interfaces and the Wi-Fi SSIDs, we need to talk about two more little things here. First, there are two exceptions which we need to define for the guest network. As we deny access to the router itself, a client from the guest network is blocked from two essential services. The first one is DNS. I have briefly expanded on that before. The second one is DHCP. We do not want our guests to define IP addresses for themselves. This should be seamlessly provided by the DHCP server on the router. So for DNS and DHCP, we need to define two exception rules. This is done on the Traffic Rules tab. Let's add a new rule here. I want to call it Guest DHCP and DNS. We can pack both in one rule. Protocols are UDP and TCP, even though DNS would strictly speaking only need TCP and DHCP only UDP, but then we would need two rules. The source zone is guest. The destination zone is input, so this device. And the destination ports used for DHCP and DNS are 53, 67 and 68. Action is accept, of course. Cool, let's save, then save and apply. Next, let's quickly talk about masquerading on NAT, which is short for Network Address Translation. The number of IPv4 addresses is limited. There are more devices on this planet than public IP addresses. Therefore, some IP address ranges are private, namely the 10.x range, the 172.x range, and the 192.168 range. You can do whatever you want in these ranges, and these addresses will never be routed in the internet. But how could the packet find its way back to us if it comes from one of those private addresses? We just tell the router to masquerade everything that goes out to the internet with a public IP address of its WAN interface. This can be done in two ways. Either by ticking the box Masquerade here on the zones, or by adding a specific NAT rule here on the NAT rules table. Awesome! Our firewall setup is complete and we can now add the interfaces. We click on Network, then Interfaces. At the bottom, I click on Add New Interface. I call the first interface Guest. As protocol, I will use a static address and please tick the box Bridge Interfaces. This will help us in the next episode when we add VLANs to extend to a second access point. Leave the interface unspecified for the time being. Click on Create Interface and now we can type in all details. Let's give the guest interface an address in the 10.x range, for example 10.20.30.40. Very often routers have the .1 address at the end, but there is no rule for this. I chose a class C network mask, that is 3x255.0, and I leave everything else at default values on this tab. Just need to make sure that the router acts as a DHCP server. So I click on the DHCP server tab and click on Setup DHCP server. The default values should be okay for most use cases. Last but not least, we need to assign the interface to a firewall zone. This is done on the Firewall Settings tab, and here we can specify, of course, the guest zone. Let me quickly do the same thing with the IoT network. Pretty much the same steps, just a different IP address range. Here I choose the 172.18.18.19 address. Just any address I randomly picked out of the private address range. Great! Last but not least, let's add the Wi-Fi interfaces. Let's click on Network, then Wireless. As you can see, I have two Wi-Fi network cards, one for 2.4 GHz and one for 5 GHz. The most important setting here is the security. Guys, I will not go into detail on the wireless settings. I have already made a couple of Wi-Fi videos. Please do watch those if you have questions on bandwidth, roaming, etc. Just one detail here. We need, of course, to add the right interface to the right firewall zone. So IoT for the IoT Wi-Fi and guest for the guest Wi-Fi, of course. That's it. Save, then save and apply, and we are done. Perfect. We have successfully segmented our network into three firewall zones. We have a Wi-Fi for guests, for the LAN, and for our IoT devices with adapted policies. Guys, that concludes today's episode. In the next episode, we will extend the three Wi-Fis to a second access point over a single cable using VLANs. Until then, many thanks for watching, liking, and subscribing. Stay safe, stay healthy. Bye for now.